writers that I've invited to come because there's so much power and force in this particular congregation. It's like, so they showed up, it's like, oh, wow. I just wanted to say again, thank you for being here. We're here to be inspired and to allow that part of our knowing to warm up. As you know, poetry is a form of expression that's realized in our own experience when we hear it. And we all are endowed with poetry, but it needs to be stimulated. So I'm very happy to be here with Roger Hecht, David Weiss, Cory Brown, Mary Gilliland, and Dan Rosenberg, and myself. And we each have just a few minutes to read, so I'm going to take a seat and invite Roger to come right up.
Festival together, and it's very exciting to be here. I've been in this room only in the audience. There, you know, children's theater programs and stuff, so it's kind of weird to see it from this angle. But it is a gorgeous space. I understand the theme is flowers, and some of my poems have flowers, some of them don't, but I will do my best to give you at least one flower. But this is my most Ithaca poem. And it is based on an actual event that took place at the gas station on Meadow, the one that's full service, you know that? So you can imagine being at the gas pumps. It's called Witness Report. You couldn't tell distress in the duck's face, not from the distance we watched it. Maybe in her gait, or in the rapid turn of her head with the traffic whizzing past. Certainly, the raft of ducklings strung in a line then rushing in behind her showed, at the very least, confusion. The duck popped a granite curb the ducklings couldn't leap. It seemed a storybook tragedy was playing out before us. A man tried herding them to the sidewalk, waving off cars that slowed and fortunately didn't wreck. And when the ducks turned back across the road, we knew the resulting mess would form the stories the dozen of us watching hopelessly, helplessly from the gas station pumps might tell our friends that night at dinner or over drinks. We're a sentimental town. But all the lights were with them. A woman lifted duckling after duckling from the blacktop to the grass, where the duck and brood regrouped and could safely wander to their certain deaths sometime off in the future. And so, one by one, we all drive off with a great appreciation of just what kind of world we have made. So, that one didn't have flowers, but it did have a sort of hopeful outlook, I think. This one has flowers. I'll let you decide if it's hopeful or not. It's called Dazed. It begins with a line from William Carlos Williams, many of you will probably recognize. Dazed spring approaches, the sluggard, dragging out in excruciating steps, a programmed dance all but random to the eye. The winter aconite blossoms, then the crocus, the daffodil, the cherry, delicate at the tips of their branches, blossom. But the trees that huff and puff in windstorms can barely squeeze out a leaf. As hard as it tries to dress itself, nature's more naked than ever. The birds go mad. Red-winged blackbirds scream themselves hoarse. Get it done! Get it done! Still, that thrill to see a color unexpectedly pop from the gray leaf litter. Soon enough, the woods will be an unreadable green mass. Then it's summer and the game's up, exhausted from the heat and anxiety that soon it will all be over. Then the cold weight of the clouds, the weight all over again. And I want to stay within the time. teach in Oneonta, so about 2 hours to the east of here. So I kind of, half my life is there, half my life is here. Here, there, everywhere. But lately I started writing Oneonta poems, so I thought I would try this one out. Driving out of Oneonta, west toward the sun, already sunk below the hills, not dark enough to be dusk, but getting there. The Susquehanna, just beyond a short patch of pasture and some future cornfields, barely bigger than a creek at this point. This divided highway makes a much bigger footprint, though the floodplain is substantially wider. Every dozen years or so, the river reminds us of who owns what. Spring is rushing ahead of itself, the steep foothills rapidly greening. The deft lacework of branches will soon be sown solid. Snow, a distant memory, the season out of whack. In the open space of empty lanes before me, a bald eagle slowly coasts across the highway toward the mountain, wings stretched flat, eyes level, an effortless low glide. I had to do a double take to catch the white tail feathers to confirm what I'd seen. I know they nest nearby, their presence discreet, a heroic return. Deer were once like that. When I was a kid, a deer appearing at the edge of my school's ball field sent everyone to the window, gawking at these ghosts haunting our clean suburban woods. Even the woods were once a rarity, cleared for crops that wouldn't grow and dairy cows that did. All it took was a calamity to resurrect the forest. Depression, capital flight, jobs outsourced to the lowest bidder. And the deer in abundance, and the fox, and the ticks they carry with them all came clambering back. So confident of themselves, they don't startle when I walk my dog at night. They stand their ground on the neighbor's lawn, watching warily. The eagle owned the air I drove through. I held the wheel with both hands. I swear it turned its golden eye toward me as it passed, or maybe it just looked ahead. Who can read an eagle's expression? Sadly, there's no way I can take a picture of that. We can give it back. We can have it all. It just takes a calamity. You'll just have to take my word for it. I think that's probably my time up. So.
Got a couple in it that's worth the price of admission, to say the least. And it, you know, flower imagery, you know, it's sort of like, flower imagery is kind of hit and run, right? There's flowers that may occupy a line or a part of a line or something like that. But, you know, this is a poem about a flower, which is, you know, a hard thing to do. I still haven't found it.
I think you just kind of turn that box. It's lower.
Oh, I see. Yeah. It did seem to be falling.
I think it's just you turn the whole top itself.
Really?
Yeah, I think so.
No.
Turn the other way.
It is getting low. If I'd be great, it'd be like a pecking plant, just sinking right in. All right, I'll hold it.
You want a new one?
What's that?
Yeah, look for a new one.
No, in 1834, he's like 31 years old. And it's about a flower that lives in the woods, kind of a flower that, you know, kind of cool, but nobody runs across it.
Could you go a little closer to the mic?
Oh, yeah.
I want this to pick you up.
Okay. In May, when sea winds pierced our solitudes, I found the French rhodora in the woods, spreading its leafless blooms in a damp nook to please the desert and the sluggish brook. The purple petals fallen in the pool made the black water with their beauty gay. Here might the redbird come his plumes to cool and court the flower that cheapens his array. Rhodora, if the sages ask you why this charm is wasted on earth and sky, tell them, dear, that, and here it comes, if eyes were made for seeing, then beauty is its own excuse for being. Why thou were there, O rival of the rose, I never thought to ask. I never knew, but in my simple ignorance supposed, the self-same power that brought me there brought you. So Emerson's basic idea from Nature and elsewhere's great essays is that what nature does for us is it gives us a language to talk and understand ourselves. Without it, we don't have a mirror to sort of, in some weird way, reflect back to us or give us a way of understanding our own experience. And that's what symbols do. Okay. So here's a poem from an English manuscript. You know this blue song by Elizabeth Cotton, Freight Train, Going So Fast, Freight Train Going So Fast, Please Don't Tell What Train On. She wrote this when she was like 11. And it's really, you know, it seems like a lighthearted poem, but it's really about the horse escaping and escaping the South. So I had never thought about that exactly, and it just led me to some sort of riff upon that situation. This is called Please Don't. Please don't, she said. The ditches were shining with water nervy with wind. He was standing too close across the road. She held a suitcase by the handle between its latches. It was spring, bright, cold, nothing yet started to grow. Her coat was too thin. She had no sweater on. He was too close, his head in his hands. Please don't, she said to the knives in the air. From the cold, her eyes teared. A car stopped. She got in. She looked around. The look said, please don't tell the train I'm on. He placed a stone at her head, a stone at her feet. North was south, west was east. It was colder than she was, colder than him. Bells like talons came down from the sky. Please don't, she'd said. Don't make this something it's not. Birds were being flown away, no tears in their eyes. A dog stood on three legs, panting by the woods, all bone and skin. It was home, if home were no such thing. Hardly spring, no gold in the goldenrod, no burrs in the burdock. Where she was going, harder and gone. The stone was for his head. The dog was by his feet. There wasn't anything he wouldn't have done. There wasn't anything she didn't mean by, please don't. Last poem is called Nights Are Colder. And the flowers are blue. There's sun today, and sunflowers, and a glint in the lake, the silvery flanks of suns. The well said, even the well made, won't save you. Bereavements pile up like dead cows bulldozed into the seethe of the compost heap.
Nothing left of them but iris, eye sockets in 3 weeks' time. Wishfulness, like those flesh eaters, is a siege engine. In last night's dream, a snowplow was rusting in the rainforest, and a metal voice was droning, "Lemon is to lemonade, as column is to colonnade, as mask is to masquerade." Our throats are opened by insolvency and delight and abide with me. The forklift, which doesn't care one way or the other, will raise up the seed box of winter wheat. If you can tell threadbare from worn out, used up from unreusable, you can take your place at the end of the line. The toddler who goes around calling, "Hey, you," like a tree keeper, says it equally to truck and hen and the cloud like moon.
Seemed far away.
Yeah. All right.
Hi, folks. So this is in reverse chronological order, only because the segues are more appropriate. But so you have to imagine, I think more July here, when peonies are already spent. Is that maybe June, July?
June.
Peonies are gone, and it's the season of wild raspberries, bird's foot trefoil, and purple and pink clover along the roads. There's the flowers, my friend. On mild, cool mornings, on our walks, we'll circle around to the orchard to see how much the little apples have grown. New tiger lilies and chicories everywhere. If there is such a thing as heaven, it's in our capillaries. This past week, there's been a dry spell, so grass in people's yards is getting brittle. But the nights are cool, and with the smell of fresh mowings, it's as if the fireflies' little lights are trying to say something profound. We'll remember you when you're in the ground. That's a sonnet, thus the couplet at the end. That's a wishful thinking poem. I remember you. Probably not. This is a tribute to George Floyd, who was killed in late May, as you call it. Buttercups, azaleas, and lilacs are blooming, flocks too. Adorning with colors a whole hillside near my house. Next to these beauties, storming the streets is violent and vulgar, wholly beside the point, unnecessary emotion and vexation. We're concerned, of course, more with how we treat one another and with the formation of laws and the ethical tenets we're to bestow on our children than we are with, per se, beauty. But on TV, I saw bouquets for George Floyd, where he was killed and displayed almost as a duty. This is the aesthetics of obligation, an unalloyed homage to his rights, to his human dignity, and to our dedication to the death of iniquity. This is a little more celebratory, though I'm not sure if it is toward the end, you tell me. So we're in April, reverse chronology. It's April, this is called to live. It's April again, and winter hangs on as if by a spider's thread. Crocuses flashing the bright yellows and purples, weeping willows with their wispy costumes, looking like ghosts from afar. Japanese magnolias dropping their blossoms already. Bushes everywhere threatening to push out buds like those tiny fingers we see in pictures of embryos. Even irises are up, their shoots pointing to the sky in astonishment. Look, it's almost here. Certainly no one wants to shovel snow. No one wants to heave onto their backs once again the winter gear. We want to see dark clouds pregnant with rain rolling into the neighborhood with lightning on their tails. We want thunderheads to shoot up like the skyscrapers we know them to be. How many more springs will I be rewarded? That's what we are we not? Seasons, one after the other. We want to see ourselves in another and another, like fresh-breasted robins, hopping from worm to worm, wriggling out of the soil. That's us, too, wriggling out of the soil. Raw desire. We want to see forsythia showing off their bloomers, saucy forsythia. We want to see young cosmos swaying in the warm pre-storm wind, like flamenco dancers twisting their torsos, chins high up, arms swaying. We want to see rain pour down like music to make the flowers dance in the wet wind. Would I come back, I ask myself, as an early cosmos swaying in the wind? What about Trillium, or Snowdrop, or Spring Beauty, or Johnny Jumbo? A squirrel, or blue jay, or a snowy owl swooping down on a field mouse? What about a field mouse? Would I come back as a field mouse, swooped down upon by a snowy owl? Yes. Yes, I will. Name it, and I will live it. A tree, even. What about tree bark, or a leaf, or a mite on a leaf? A caterpillar munching on it. A microbe and a drop of rainwater on the leaf. Or on a fresh blade of grass. What about a flea? Would I be a flea in an alley cat's fur? What about flea poop? Would I come back as flea poop? Tiny spots of half-digested blood on a dog's belly or a possum's crotch? Yes, yes, I would.
Chained to joy. They scroll the sky with chrysanthemum and thunder. We strap ourselves in, hang on tight against the clouds, our velocity taut with their presence. Our rounds of celebration filled with their empty chairs. Now about persistence. Can you see the flowers on this magazine? this is Tampa Review. It's a wonderful magazine. And the poem I'm going to read is going to be in a book that will be published in 2024 by my publisher, Kaiho Press. Blossoms burst every which color. When I took charge of the cemetery, the robin was in the rose. Nestlings with yellow-lined beaks shoveled the air for food. A parent with worm perched the spit-woven grass and twigs like a headstone. In the nod of soldier girl, equal in combat, was finding her orderly way to a little nest. Accordion girl chirped her way through another forced lesson. Boy girl was climbing the tree with apples to eat the cyanide seeds. Thorn were the corporate sheets and the banks, pine roots and taproots in nations. Thorned was the reach of anyone left in the wake of commodities traders. The rose rambled with wrinkled leaves, orange hips of fragrance like cloves. The rose climbed 6 sunny feet, unbothered by pests or diseases. The rose rooted one with the fire of doubling, hybridization, mutation. Of all birdsong, the robin's repeated one is most grating. And it rained so much all summer that I mowed, mowed, mowed the lot under. This band carries books around with us, and I just want to say that we probably all have books to sell after the reading if you want to meet us outside. This is a poem about one flower. And you can trust the fact about this herb, this wildflower, that you are about to hear. Motherwort, W-O-R-T, is often the end of the name of a wildflower, and it's from the Anglo-Saxon. It means plant. Motherwort, as forest green leaves reverse in wind, dusty silver undersides, veins bulge. Embryonic rings of spurred seeds, halt hands slide at intervals along the tall, four-sided stalk. Leonora's cardiata has a robin Sherwood shine, a slightly darker, slightly danker nature than its fellow leaves. Minute orchids top the taloned seed crowns, propate visors. Whence the fomentative power, plucked, bruised, steeped, to break fever, lift childbirth cramp. My motherwort has been used for, in childbirth by people that knocked on my door being referred to me because I have a lot that grows around my place. I should also say I have extensive gardens, and if you know of anyone looking for a part-time weeding job starting on Monday, send them to me. The last one I'll read is from a chapbook, The Ruined Walled Castle Garden, and this too is also going to be in the new book next year. Earthly Mishaps. The plant in this is named Mare's Tail. And for those of you that like mystery series, Brother Cadfael makes an appearance in this poem. Earthly Mishaps. Faint, humming, inexorable in the damp below the ruined walled castle garden. Mare's tail tunnels an 8-foot root. Swaggered, I've stayed in the circle, reached to my elbow. Still the plant breaks. As Eve brought a man his labor, it will multiply tenfold. I shot for survival. A sprayer to level pride, melancholy, and unwanted shoots. The canister is lowered from its shelf, bagged in plastic. The till rings. Keys in hand, I see the car park as a horse-tracked swale where Cadfael leads his roan, saddlebag with an apothecary box. Medieval herbicide? As he stumps through mud, the monk's brass scale tips. one man sways with the bitterness of interrupted life. The other heaves radical helplessness.
So nice to be here among this group of poets who know all this stuff about plants, and I don't know anything about plants. And I don't know anything about flowers, and I thought I'd start with a poem about that. Actually, this poem, Ada Limon read this on the Slowdown, which is her, it's not hers anymore, it's a podcast where you just have someone read you a poem a day, and talk about it a little bit, and then read the poem. Major Jackson is running it now. It's great. If you like hearing poems, you should just subscribe to the Slowdown. But I bring it up because when she read the last line in a way that made it clear that she thought it was like hopeful and optimistic and upbeat. I was like, that is classic Ada and not what I meant. It is. It's one. It's an option. This poem's called Weaving. I shove through bush and bed, stumbling along our house. Somewhere I learned not to let the plants grow too close. Something about airflow, rot, our home's slow demolition by vine. I wrap my hand around a dandelion, pull into the tension, breathless, for the slight snap of roots, then harden until the earth releases it or it gives up its hold on the ground. I sunder something deep. Throw the plant with its knot of dirt to the driveway. The foliage extends. A branch slaps back, leaves an archipelago of blood along my calf. Another, I don't know their names, just pull with faith in the prior owner and her fertile excess that even my blunders won't undo. One white twig feels hollow, comes loose in my hand, but what of it was underground is red as a crime, bent and beckoning. The spring's first accidental sweat catches in the corners of my squint. When I stand upright, survey my labor, nothing looks better. So she definitely heard, nothing looks better. It was like, it was as good as it could possibly look. What a lovely thought there. This one's called To Wait from a Crowded Dream Alone. And this is one of those poems where the title bleeds right into the first line. So, to wake from a crowded dream alone is sweeter than the bee's delicate legs, sweeter than paper, than the maple weeping through the coattails of winter. I wake to the house wren's staccato song. He wants a mate, drab little bird. So he sings a promise of home, mostly to the wrong audience, me. He cracks the shell of sleep as if the world were daily hatched. And I declare to the wall his desperate lonely song is sweet. Sweet as my son panting into a globe of dandelion seeds, believing his regular breath can set them to flight. He holds tight the wonder of tiny feathers drifting away from his lips, the sudden transformation to unremarkable stump and stem in his fist. He's bright-eyed and thoughtless of where the seeds will fall and what will grow there. But now, he's elsewhere. The wren is past the window. I've scraped the pulp of sleep from my eyes, and it is spring. The light passes through each new torn leaf. The bearded irises look sexual and alien. They huddle together, sprouts of forgotten bulbs. They don't remind us of us. Their heads devout with color, jostled indirectly toward the sun. What reminds us of us are the thin holes in the skin of the bed, separating each thread of grass, each twig, just a twig, not yet the next. From the space inside each iris, the stamen lifts its grains of pollen, their solitude and potential unconsidered. And when the bee translates them to a neighbor, this meeting is an accident. So familiar, this being brought together by someone else's hunger. Hope you're okay. he's wandering off, hopefully to get some water. Just the last poem is actually, I'm cheating. It's about flowers, sort of, but it's about this painting. The roses of Heliogabalus, who was a Roman emperor, who perhaps apocryphally was accused of drowning guests in, there's like a false ceiling, and he would just drop all of these flower petals. You're nodding like you know the story. And he would drop so many flowers that it would actually suffocate some of his guests. This was part of the sort of excess and madness of the Roman emperor. But what I loved about this painting is that they're back here looking like awful voyeurs, and then the people involved have inscrutable expressions. It's unclear what's happening, whose side they're on, if they understand that their sides can be taken. And so it's a really cool painting if you want to check it out. So this is a poem called The Roses of Heliogabalus. Am I losing my mind? There was weird stuff happening with lights. We're
yes.
Cool.
Sorry,
it's
cool.
Oh.
We're great. This is the feel. I like it. The roses of Heliogabalus. Crammed with storm in the ire flow of painterly kitsch. Petals. Endless drifting bodies rendered illusion of motion. Pink as pink everywhere. Another Etna, the pretty, the dead, redhead staring out is suffering or source. What's still here? Metal shadows in the distance, column-colored arm draped on a shoulder, feasters undercover looking, all these ditties of no tone. Imagine the riot of stink when swamped by excess. Imagine beauty snarled and rent. But where's the other storm of stems and thorns and the revelers full of knowing therein?
Oh, thank you again to the writers. It's a little bit like speed dating. Each of the writers deserves hours of our listening. We could work on that. But again, you know, the Beatles only had like 6 minutes and they had Sullivan stuff. This poem doesn't have a flower, but it does have flora. It's entitled Palmetto. And for some reason I was thinking about Whitman's poem Crossing Brooklyn Ferry, where he refers to the stuff of the world, the objects, the buildings, the rivers. And he refers to them as beautiful dumb ministers, which furnish their part to the soul. Palmetto. It was me. I did it. In a stringy wood in Florida, I tore it from its mother, sawing away with my motel key. I stole, stealing from the green, green world. I don't know if I invoke the sacred name of sorrow or the ragged name of fear. I remember striding into the hospital with its head down by my side and how the woman in the next bed recognized it immediately. It's on the list, she said, and meant a better one than you could ever find in a hospital ward in Florida. Or any other state, for that matter. What we did then was just look at it. The little saw palmetto with its green and juvenile crown fans. A small, shy prince, almost apologetic, even as it lifted and spread its bright deck and serene face. Have you ever seen one? This one had already begun to be a light in the world, taking its place between two women, one sick and one injured. Endangered species. I still remember how it looked, as if being endangered meant that it knew from the very beginning what sadness was and what its work would be. Far from home, far from the green, green world. April is the cruelest month. It is spring and I am on speaking terms with the sun and the dead tree turned green, standing like an artist in good air. If it trembles, it is not with doubt or fear, but air rising into a blue and perfect sky. A quiet master no one is pointing to. It is spring and I haven't looked up in months. But now I see the world has a skirt and blouse, and the sidewalks are better for it, and the roads and buildings. April, month of mortal fire, is the cruelest. But like a sophist of flowers, I've begun to believe in the red cups, and the yellow cups, and the small green fangs pushing through hard winter soil. Could there be a harder worker than the flower, anything more eager for its destiny? At my level of sophistication, I do not distinguish. They are all lobelias to me, or hibiscus, or Buddha, by the final lectern, holding forth the flower, this one, which at least I know is not the flower of yesterday, or the flower of tomorrow. Today, as my parents, whose hair is now pure white, drove away, going back to their home, I saw a tree with small white bells pour down everything it had, as if to say, without pathos or pride, look at this. As it laid down the designs of its life in the street where we walk, where we make our lives. Can you give me a name for that street flower, a figure of life that is not mortal? It is spring, and I am in the backyard charting the progress of the world. What the trees propose, I am inclined to accept. And for now, that which doubts and fears regards the flower and is on speaking terms with the sun. The theme was the persistence of flowers in contemporary poetry, and I think we did a lot of showing, we didn't need to be telling in a poetic way. One of the inspirations for the idea was a line from a poem by Ted Hughes, which was, "We don't want your soppy flowers." It's from the Little Boys and the Seasons. And I was thinking a little bit about when I heard that, you know, just the way in which flowers can be kind of cliche. But I certainly appreciated what David had to say in terms of Emerson explaining what flowers are doing for us. In this poem I referred to an astronaut, I think it was Neil Armstrong, who, when he looked back at Earth from space, described Earth as a beautiful blue flower. In that dark vastness, and then he said, and then I burst into tears, thinking about what was going on that planet.